What's up, everybody? Hey, thanks for coming back. Brian Tong here with Insider Look. And today we got a special guest, Ash Jhaveri, the Vice President of Realtiy Labs Partnerships at Meta. You might have heard of that company. Ash, thanks so much for hanging out, man.
Absolutely. My pleasure. Thanks for having me.
Can you tell us really more about your vision and Meta's vision for the metaverse and some of the progress you have made so far?
Yeah, totally. One thing though, I will say, like, while we may have like shifted the brand of the company a year ago, we've been working on this for almost like 9 years. You know, if you think about sort of the evolution of VR, and in many ways we've been working on this since really day one. Because for us it really is about, you know, what is the next evolution? What is the evolution for human connection, right? What is the evolution for the internet look like? Because, you know, fundamentally we're about connection and community and bringing people together. If you look at like what the industry is doing, you know, people are hiring like chief metaverse officers. There's a bunch of companies that are now really deep, you know, deep into, you know, into the work. It just shows that people are finding value, right? And what that also means is that developers are making money, right? And so you see a lot of momentum and sort of developer velocity, which, you know, is to me one of the big sort of gauges of like ecosystem. The other thing that we're seeing, you know, from what people are doing, we are, you know, sort of started off as a standalone, sort of, I'm going to play games, I'm going to sort of get into a type of an experience. And now when you look at the Quest store and what people are doing, the top three apps are all social apps. So people are really starting to spend time together, which again is our thesis and really why we exist as a company. And now the technology has gotten more levels of fidelity. You know, in our latest headset, we can actually like now track, you know, eyes and facial expression so that like your avatar, I can see when you're wrinkling your nose or furrowing your eyebrows, and that just brings you closer together, right? And it makes you feel more connected. And so the fact that social is really taking off, you know, is like another really great sign. And then it's not just gaming anymore. People are doing fitness. It's a huge vertical now. You know, we've launched a bunch of accessories and, you know, things around fitness specifically, so that you can box better, you can golf better. And then productivity is really the third use case that we're seeing a lot of momentum in. People are really starting to use the products to get stuff done at work.
I did not think that I would be someone who does, you know, a lot of activities and fitness, and to be sucked in by, you know, the supernatural VR boxing experience and actually consistently use it. It's incredible. Like it really is a unique, one of a kind experience that you actually like, I sweat the heck out of. But, you know, we talk about Meta and the metaverse, and I know and you know that people still aren't necessarily haven't wrapped their heads around this. You know, in the tech community, in the tech audience, we do understand it, but there's a lot of people that still have not been able to wrap their head around this completely. So maybe what are some of the challenges that you are facing and addressing when it comes to the metaverse?
I think you hit on it, which is, you know, the real magic is when you put one of these things, on from a VR perspective, right? It's like, I think it's like one of the greatest marketing challenges of our generation is like, how do I actually help you understand and experience something that fully immerses you? It's kind of like, you know, how can I really market like London to you without you walking down the streets of London and really experiencing the smells and the sights and the streets and the cars coming from the opposite direction? Like, I can show you pictures, but I can't really transport you there until you're there. And it's a similar thing with the headset is until you try it on, it's really hard to describe what present looks like. One thing I will say, though, is like, you know, VR is a small component of our metaverse vision, right? When I think about human connection, sort of embodied internet, bringing people closer together, I think for the longest time, like, you know, mobile phones aren't going anywhere. Right. And so, you know, being able to like be in this immersive experience, whether you're on the web, on your PC, you know, on a mobile phone, on a TV, you know, or a headset, all of these need to be access, you know, ways to access, you know, this embodied internet. So when you think about us and you think about sort of our metaverse vision, yes, VR is a component of it and it'll be a big component of it, but there's the entire other set of devices that we also enable. And so, you know, all of our metaverse products, if you think about Horizon Worlds and the other ones, will be on sort of all devices and surfaces. Similarly with, you know, a lot of our workplace, you know, products as well. If you're video conferencing, it's great if you have a headset and you're in the room and you can be a, you know, an avatar and talk to your coworker sitting next to you, but you can also zoom into it, or you can be on Teams, or you can be, you know, like sort of on 2D video conference as well. And so everybody has equity and inclusion and access to it, a different level of experience based on the hardware, which we see, all the time in the industry.
I think you're right on the nose when you say you just have to experience it, because as a tech reviewer, one of the early challenges, like, okay, can we capture the content that I'm experiencing and show it to someone on screen? And even with a screen capture, it just doesn't do it justice, right? And it's, to your point, it's one of those things that people have to try on. And I think the Quest 2 has been an amazing product from a price point standpoint, where the barrier of entry was a lot more affordable and accessible.
Yeah.
And that really opened the eyes of a lot of people that I know that never tried VR and experienced that. And I know we talk about beyond just VR, right? Mixed reality and augmented reality. And you've been holding the Quest Pro, showing it some love, because this thing just dropped. It just launched. Like, I have one over in its box. I will be reviewing it, but it's crazy season right now. But I would love to hear from you. You know, what excites you about the Quest Pro right now?
Yeah. I think this is, I touched on some of these things earlier, but, I think it's ultimately it's the experiences that it unlocks. And so, but like, I will spend a second, because we're so proud. I'm so proud of the yeah, hardware itself. It. It's actually funny. It's actually a little bit heavier than the Quest, but because of the way that we've built the Ergo, if you look at sort of the back plating here, the distribution, the battery in the back, it feels way lighter on the head, which sort of helps with, all day wearability. A couple of really cool high res color cameras. So when you put the headset on, you're no longer in this like sort of black screen, right? While you're waiting for it to boot, you actually see the world around you in full color. And then, the things start overlaying on top of it. And so you don't lose that sense of presence with the real world, that sense of connection with the real world either, unless you want to, and you want to get immersed as well. And, really the other great thing about these cameras is they start letting developers build MR, like true mixed reality applications, so that I can start, putting objects on the table. If you're in a meeting and you're working on a jet engine, you can have that engine sitting on the table with your colleagues around you, and only the jet engine is virtual, right? And everyone else you can sort of see there as well. And this gives developers a good path to start building for the future and our future devices, which will have, mixed reality in them as well. And then the last thing we were touching on a little bit is that there's sensors on the inside that really allow more social presence, right? So allowing and sort of being able to see when I'm smiling, when I'm furrowing my brow. You can try to stick your tongue out. It's not going to work. We don't quite track.
No
that
tongue
yet,
detection but, yet. No tongue detection
not yet.
Yet.
Not yet.
Okay. Waiting
but,
for it.
But the current sort of state of the art is really simulating like these little micro movements that we make, with your avatar. The real thing is, how do I actually truly replicate it? And we're on a big step forward on that. And so, if I think about the experiences that this can unlock, like deeper social connection, more mixed reality, and more sort of like wearability, and certainly the optics, I sort of didn't touch on the pancake lenses that like compress things, give better visual acuity, so you can browse web pages or spreadsheets if you're so inclined, or just generally read text and things are far more legible. Which again, all these things I think accrue to developers being able to build like much cooler experiences.
No, I mean, I think what's also important to note is, I've seen a lot of people, the conversations and talk around it. And yes, it is a more expensive headset compared to the Quest 2, but it's targeting kind of a different audience. And some people say, okay, is this more enterprise geared or not? How do you see this device?
The first thing I would say is, certainly the price is higher than the Quest. But if you think about the technology that we packed in here, like ounce for ounce, gram for gram, it really is state of the art, right? And like, I like to think back, dating myself a little bit, but like when the first like flat screen TVs came out, like circa.
Now you're really dating yourself, Ash. You better be careful here, okay?
Yeah, I know. I hope the audience, I hope some people in the audience remember this, but like, sort of like 99, 2000-ish. Like I remember like a friend of mine like paid 10 grand for a 40-inch like plasma, considered low def today TV, and we all went over there and like watched Saving Private Ryan, and like you could just hear the surround sound and see the bullets. Like that was amazing. It was like 10 grand, right? Like today I can walk into like a Costco and probably get like an 80-inch TV for like less than 2 grand. So, technology curves, like, the state of the art is always the most expensive. Those technology curves always slow down. And so we're pretty confident that like a lot of the technology that we packed in here, ends up making it into the consumer line, into like the next version of the Quest, which we've talked about, the consumer version as well. So it'll come, right? It'll come. It'll allow us to harden it today. Developers can build on it today, which means more content available for consumers tomorrow. And then, you know, I would say it's less about the price for in terms of sort of the enterprise and the productivity thing as much as it is about like what I've been talking about, which is like sort of the visual clarity, the all day wearability, the more expressive avatars. All those things lend itself to be like a really great sort of, you know, getting work done. Everything we haven't talked about the input, but the controllers have much finer granularity and control. You should try playing you could play Operation now, if you remember that game, which you could never do with the other controllers. There's the input as well. So it's more about like sort of the state of the technology and what's unlocking than it is like the price point. And, you know, but how that said, like, you know, we announced this sort of, we announced a bunch of big partnerships around the enterprise space.
Yeah. Let's talk about some of those partnerships that you have going on with enterprise. I'm curious to hear about them.
Yeah. I mean, we had our Connect event a couple of weeks ago and announced a whole bunch of different partnerships, both on the consumer side and more on the enterprise side. I'll touch on the enterprise ones first. We announced a series of partnerships with companies like Adobe, Autodesk, and Zoom, who are bringing their apps and services, you know, to the headset. We also announced a huge partnership with Microsoft. Microsoft is bringing Teams and Teams VR to the headset. They're integrating Teams into our workplace, into our Workrooms product as well, so that, you know, some of the calling that I was talking about, if people, you know, people want to dial into a call that's in VR, they're able to bring in Teams. We have enterprise device management, which is a big thing for IT administrators, you know, being able to actually remotely wipe and manage and track devices to get onto the corporate network. And then, you know, Windows and the Office suite is also coming to the headset. So you've kind of got the full productivity power of the Microsoft, you know, sort of suite now available and, you know, for use in the headset. And then the corollary to that we also announced a much larger partnership with Accenture. You know, Accenture is like the biggest, I think one of the biggest enterprise customers of our headset, over 60,000 deployed. And they give a new one to each employee. And, you know, they're going to be working with us very closely on making sure enterprises can adopt and bring a bunch of their use cases into VR.
Are there any big themes just in general? You're the closest to this stuff around the metaverse that maybe people should be paying attention to in this space for 2023?
Yeah, you know, I think there's a few things that I would, you know, that I sort of keep my eye on. You know, we continue, and obviously this is sort of a part of mine and my team's job, but we just continue to build this ecosystem together, right? I mean, I think the number one thing, you know, here is to like know that we're not going to build this ourselves. But it really is about building an ecosystem. We have a role in it. We have some hardware in it. We have a point of view, we bring connection, we bring people. But you know, without companies like Adobe and Microsoft, and you know, we're gonna talk about a lot of the consumer ones with like NBC Universal is gonna bring a bunch of their great movie content, you know, to the headset, you know, as well in various ways, whether it's a Horizon World or t-shirts for your avatars or even in parks, you know, as well. So there's a lot of companies that I would sort of track, and I would urge folks to sort of think about how, you know, you can use the technology from a VR perspective, you know, to further your business, whether it's engaging with your customers or your, you know, pushing your brand further or getting work done or just building great experiences for people to either play or connect or work out. All of these things are, I think, going to be far more possible, you know, going into the future. And we've got a lot more folks coming on board as well. So I keep an eye on just how the ecosystem develops, and I hope that when we talk in a year, you know, we've got like 5x the number of stuff that we were just talking about today. And it's really all about the developers and the community that are gonna build around it.
That's awesome. So Ash, I just want to say we're excited to see you all over at CES 2023 and see what you have in store with us. But thank you so much for your time. And yes, I'm gonna go play around with that Quest Pro.
Likewise, I look forward to it. It's been a couple of years, obviously, since we've all gotten to get together in Vegas, and so I'm looking forward to being back into the show.
All right, see ya.
Thank you.